welcome to the vote here at Latest TV. I'm Mike Mendoza. I'm joined today by the former head of UKIP in West Sussex, Mike Glennon. Welcome to you.
Thanks, Mike. Hello again.
Did you fall or were you pushed?
No. It was negotiated 12 months in advance. It was coming, so no coups in UKIP.
Really. I mean, you were such a dynamic leader, and you've brought an awful lot to West Sussex over the last couple of three years. Far more than you ever thought you would. Yeah?
Well, indeed, I've been fighting as an activist in UKIP for a very long time, as you know. I've been a member since 2003. I spent 3 years as the leader of the opposition on county. It's been passed over now to another very capable colleague because I wanted to focus more of my time on the referendum and also the recent local elections where UKIP did incredibly well across the Lancing area.
Let's just talk about the local elections first. And you did well. You sort of retained your seats and gained a seat.
Yeah, we defended two seats we had to defend. Mm-hmm. We gained two more. This is Ada District. And on Lancing Council, we've taken full control, 10 seats out of 16. So a really good result. And it rewards the intense hard work we've put in for a very long time, not just in campaigning, but our councillors working within councils to give very fair representation to the people, which we believe has not really been there in recent years.
For a party that was sort of described as a one-trip pony, a one-trick pony, and you were going to get in and you get your win in certain elections but never be voted in again, you proved them wrong.
Well, indeed, we've matured and broadened as a party. We've got a full manifesto of pledges and policies. People are starting to trust us as a safe pair of hands once we're in power. And I think that's a long-term trend. Obviously, the preoccupation right now is the referendum on the 23rd of June. What happens after that, we shall see. But one thing's for sure, UKIP is here to stay, and it's a proven participant in politics nowadays.
Look, mind you're not that strong away from Lancing area, though, are you?
We've got strongholds. Across West Sussex, however, the entire coastal strip has been very kind to us. We've got 10 county councillors, as you know. They were all won along the coastal strip. But the appeal is broadening further afield as well. So I think there's lots more electoral success coming our way in the future.
You've also got a fairly good proportion of representatives in the European Union.
Well, indeed, we are the biggest party. In 2014, we won overridingly, well ahead of all other parties. And those MEPs are doing a first-class job in communicating to the British people what the realities are of life within the European superstate. So they've got a very important job to do, and they'll continue to do that.
So are they working to work themselves out of a job?
It's an irony there. I don't think any one of our MEPs wants to be a European MEP for the sake of it. It's there as part of the campaign to bring independence back to Britain. We are on a mission, we're on a drive. And that has been very successful, I believe. Nigel Farage is one of the most charismatic leaders you could have, a fantastic orator. And I think we are doing all we can do now to demonstrate to the British people that on the 23rd of June, they should vote for independence and self-determination like other countries around the world, like Australia, America, India, whatever.
Many people are saying the only reason why so many people want to leave the EU is for racism, because of racism.
Well, somebody said that to me in the street just the other day. I was in Lancing campaigning, and he said, I'm not sure what to do, but quite frankly, I'm afraid it's about racism. I said, look, my wife is Malaysian. My sister-in-law is Spanish. It's nothing to do with that. What we want is to be part of a global trading environment where Britain can trade equally with all countries, not just tied to the European Union. Now, when I was a lecturer at Worthing College not so many years ago, I remember in our class we'd have British students, we'd have some European Union students, and some from China, for example. The college was charging roughly £3,000 a year to, say, an Italian student, but £9,000 a year to a Chinese or Taiwanese student because they're not part of the EU. Well, if that's not discrimination and racism, I don't know what is, but it's all part of the European model where we have to offer the same concessions to European citizens as to our own people who, let's face it, have paid into the tax kitty for decades.
What about the economic side of all this? I mean, we are talking about racism, and that has been the one thing. We don't want any more immigrants. The doors should be closed, kick people out. Originally, your whole campaign was based on £55 million a day goes to Europe.
Well,
that seems to have gone, by the way.
No, it hasn't. Oh, by the way, it's not about kicking anybody out. If Britain's an independent country, it's not about that. But what we do believe is that economically, you know, Britain is giving £350 million a week to the European Union. This is net. This is net we're giving them. Mm-hmm. I would rather see that, and UKIP would rather see that, spent on something useful here like the National Health Service or the education system. It is crazy giving this money away.
Are you getting the message across there?
We certainly are getting the message across. Mm-hmm. But there's sometimes an old saying that none are so deaf as those that don't want to listen. But, you know, both sides are finding that. People are becoming more entrenched now in what they believe. But certainly, get this very clear, trade with the European Union would continue regardless of whether we are governed from Brussels or from our own country. Lidl and Aldi are not going to pull out of the UK if Britain becomes an independent country. And BMW will still sell us very nice motorcycles, and they'll want to buy very nice Triumph motorcycles in return.
This is a man who rides motorbikes, you can obviously tell.
yes.
on that. But then you've got threats coming out of Europe,
mm-hmm.
almost contrary to what you're saying there. And then you've got the Prime Minister on a daily basis coming up with scaremongering.
Well, I think scaremongering is exactly the right word you've mentioned there, Mike. David Cameron's conduct in this referendum campaign has been quite appalling. He is doing the bidding of his global international capitalist backers by trying to break down the national state of Great Britain. And the reason they're doing that is worldwide corporations want to dismantle countries. It suits their purposes. Now, UKIP and I are no enemies of big business. Capitalism is the faithful old cart horse that pulls the whole cart along. Mm. Everything comes from the wealth generated from the private sector. But when the interests of a nation and the people may clash with that of international global capital, a prime minister should side with the people. He has not, and it's shambolic.
Should he be doing this as an individual in his own mind? He feels this is the right way to go. And he's very committed to what he's saying. And also a lot of big businesses, including the Bank of England, are backing staying in.
Well, he has his own vote, David Cameron. He has got the number one job in the country, of course. But the way he's used public money to load the campaign, the scaremongering campaign, to terrify people to stay in the European Union is quite frankly unacceptable. There are two sides to a story, but quite frankly, the case for getting out of the European Union, remaining a friendly trading neighbour and embracing global trade, global relationships, and indeed the old Commonwealth, is so strong. If people look carefully at the two arguments, I think on the 23rd of June, they will vote to get out of the European superstate.
But then if we vote out, then we're entering really a world of the unknown.
Well, the future is unknown for all of us, Mike. You know, for you, for me, when I walk up the road to my car today, I don't know what's going to happen. But I believe the risks, the very, very clear risks of staying in the European Union are enormous. The gradual dismantling.
But you don't know that, surely.
Well, what you're saying is the unknown. Mm. Either way, you don't know the future for sure.
But so therefore, you can't state a fact when it is an unknown.
I can't state it, but to me, it seems almost unarguable. The European Union is going to dismantle Britain and reduce it to a mere vassal state within the European superstate. I would rather have Britain a self-governing, independent country, which has been for centuries.
Isn't this one of the arguments that Cameron's had with the European Union in his negotiations? We are still, in a way, we are independent, still.
Well, it's fast disappearing. All British legislation is subservient to European legislation, ultimately. We cannot make any law that the European Union disapproves of. And so, therefore, no, we are not an independent country. We have no control over our borders. I have a house, I've got a door on the house, I can let in whom I please, other people I can say, sorry, you cannot come in. And this country's door has been taken off the hinges. And last year, another 330,000 additional people came to live in this country. We cannot carry on this way. We've got 70 million people here already. Just look at the strain on infrastructure, road transport, healthcare, schooling. It's just not possible to carry on this way. And we cannot control their borders if we stay in the European Union. That's why we must come out.
And again, with all due respect, the way you're talking there comes across as racist.
No, of course it's not racist. Mm. It's not about race. In this country, we have...
It is. You're talking about the amount of people coming into the country.
Well, indeed, it's about numbers. It's not about race. It's about space. If we could increase the size of this country at will, it wouldn't be a problem. If this were Australia or the United States with vast open areas, it might be different. This is one of the most crowded countries on the planet. And that's why I would say to everybody who's currently resident in this country, it is not in your interests to have a population of 80, 90 or 100 million, because that will ultimately come unless we retain control over our own borders, like the Americans do, the Australians, the New Zealanders, and most countries around the world.
But Europe is it's open door policy around the whole of Europe.
Of course it is, and that is the problem. That's not to say that people would not move around regardless. You know, I went to work in Germany back in the early 1970s on work permits, where the host country has some say and some determination of what's happening, not being in complete surrender, saying that anybody can come in and take British jobs whenever they please. Because let's face it, the children and the grandchildren of so many people I know, they are competing now for British jobs and very often losing out because the supply of labour is so high, and also what you therefore find is that
we'll continue with
wages
that
are driven down.
After the break, Mike, thanks very much indeed. Mike Glennon is our guest today, former head of UKIP in West Sussex, very much an outer in the upcoming vote. I'm back after the break. Don't go away. Welcome back to The Vote here in Latest TV. My name is Mike Mendoza, still joined by the former head of UKIP in West Sussex, Mike Glennon, who's dedicated his life and his time now to vote leave.
Recent life.
Recent life. But surely this has been your object?
Yes, of course it has. Since 2003, when I became active in the movement for an independent Britain, of course it's taken more of my time. As I become more involved in the structure of politics, of course it's taken up every waking hour of late. So therefore, my recent life has been driven by this campaign, yes it has, and I desperately hope that it'll come to fruition later on in June.
So you're around the streets, you've been in Lansing, you're in Shoreham, I think this weekend as well.
And Worthing, yes.
You've got Labour there who are doing the same thing every single week. What's been the reaction you're getting from people on the street?
I would say out of every 10 people I talk to, about 7 to 8 are in favour of coming out of the European Union. Now, across the country, of course, that will vary demographically. There'll be different areas like Brighton, London or Hartlepool might be different. But certainly in this part of the world, certainly around West Sussex, I think we'd have a very strong out vote. I think the message is getting through very clearly to these people.
I mean, looking at recent polls, I think that the ins are just edging above there.
Yeah, polls can be very interesting things to study. Very often they're inaccurate as well, as we've seen in recent years on general elections. But there's a long time to go. There's 3 weeks and more. And what I do know, of course, Mike, is there's a massive effort by government to suppress any stories coming out of Europe that might waken people up to how bad the current European Union status quo actually is becoming.
Is this sort of leading us almost into a civil war? Because there's been an awful lot of nastiness, and not in this plus infighting between various political parties. But people, even neighbours, are arguing with each other now.
Well, yes, they are. It will be divisive. And what I do believe in the long term, if you push nation states too closely together and you force them to try to meld into one, it does bring friction. Mm-hmm. And the perfect example of that historically in our time would have been the former Yugoslavia, where quite different peoples are pushed and bulldozed together. Birds of a feather often like to have a bit of freedom to flock together. They get on much better that way. And you witness now southeastern Europe, Yugoslavia, is generally at peace. Mm-hmm. Let people be free. Let them be friendly, cooperative neighbours. Don't force them together. It's against their will.
How do you answer one of the allegations, or so we're told now, almost the day after if we vote out, that we're going to go to war with Europe?
Well, it's absolute poppycock in the first degree. Some people think the European Union has been the organisation that's maintained peace since the Second World War. This is not so. It is NATO, in fact. If Britain were to leave the European Union tomorrow, there is no conceivable reason why we would have any conflicts in a military sense with anybody else across Europe. Modern, free-governing, self-determining democracies don't go to war. The trade links will be exactly the same after we leave the European Union. Why would you go to war with
your
colleagues?
But surely Europe will get together and try and do something against us. They're not just going to let it go, surely.
No, I don't think they'd be remotely interested. Mm-hmm. You know, the German housewife about to buy a British product in the supermarket does not really care. And likewise, a British housewife will freely buy French or Italian goods. Consumers want to get the right product.
It's politicians who create any
Indeed, you know, if you think mischief could be created by, say, Angela Merkel's of this world, well, the Germans sell us twice as much as we actually sell them. So why would they want to cut off the British market, which, after all, is their biggest market in Europe? They would not want to stop selling us Mercedes cars, for heaven's sake, and thereby lay off tens, hundreds of thousands of German workers and say to them, well, I'm sorry you've lost your job, but we've had to punish those naughty British consumers, so we're not sending Mercedes-Benz cars to Britain. It's nonsense.
I mean, it's not going to happen overnight anyway. If we vote to go out, it's got another 2 years at least, isn't it, before
it will be a long process of disengaging the political ties. Mm. But many of the trading ties, many of the commonplace regulations on many things could stay largely in place. It's not about tearing up every last document. It's about reinstating British self-determination where we can make the rules that apply in this country.
In your opinion, is the EU all bad? Has it got any good points at all?
No, I don't see any good points. I think it's an imperialist, expansionist project driven by a political elite. It's been tried in the past, hasn't it, historically? It's not worked. People get on better together when they are volunteering to be friendly neighbours. That can carry on. And after all, we've not been at war recently with Canada or New Zealand or Norway, have we? And we're not governed communally with those countries.
Will we see more trade with those countries in the future?
I would certainly hope so. Bear in mind, the European Union is a fast declining proportion of world trade, so Britain does need to embrace other global markets. And currently, Britain does not even have a seat on the World Trade Organization. We are not allowed by the European Union to speak to China or Australia or the United States about trade. I think we should take that seat back. We are, after all, the fifth largest economy on Earth.
The money, let's go back to the economic side now. You know, straight away we're told prices will go up, holidays will go up, travel will go up, fuel will go up.
This is utter nonsense. The European Union slaps all sorts of tariffs on non-European Union goods coming into this trading bloc. I would believe the prices largely would actually fall because we can have separate trading relationships. We can buy goods at the best prices around the globe, free from EU tariffs, and that would suit the housewife and the house husband much better, I think. Prices would fall if we're an independent country.
If you listen to your side, and you listen to the inside as well, and you try and balance it. It does balance, actually, in the end, but against each other. It's very contradictory. Everything you hear
is
very contradictory.
You have got a conflict.
How do you convince people?
Well, how you convince people is by laying out the facts and encouraging people to read carefully through both sides of the argument, free from scaremongering. A lot of the British electorate have been terrorised recently by the Conservative government saying Britain would go into a major recession overnight if we were to leave the European Union. And even last year, you remember that ridiculous documentary on Channel 4 about what would happen if a UKIP government took over. And there they had factory closures within weeks, thousands of people marching up and down unemployed. It is pure lies. And I'd like the British electorate to concentrate on the facts, not the puerile lies spouted by some people in government of late.
Again, being contradictory with each other, we heard that pensioners will be far worse off via Mr. Osborne. Then we hear from someone else, I think, I'm not sure who it was, but a fairly major person, said pensioners will be far better off.
Well,
so who do you believe?
Well, let's put it this way. Next week we'll be sending £350 million net to the European Union. I believe that could be better spent here in Britain, for example, the National Health Service. And pensioners, and I shall very soon be one, I think will be very grateful to have more money going into the National Health Service. So, no, I don't think they'll be worse off. They'll be better off.
Before the break, I asked you about, in the street, the reaction you're getting from people in the street. Are you getting a lot of people saying, well, we're not really sure, they're accusing you of being racist, and is the reason why you're not working with many of the other Brexit people is because they feel that you're tainting the whole campaign?
Well, no, indeed not. The campaigning we've carried out has not been party political. We've been fighting under the Vote Leave identity, which is the badge I'm wearing today. It's not to do with party. I've spoken to many people who might be Liberal voters or Green voters or whatever. It's the fundamental question of British independence. It's nothing to do with party politics. And so, therefore, we've worked with all of those who believe in independent Britain.
So do you believe also that the reason why you're not working with the others is because the others are too party political?
I think probably on the Out campaign, there was not really sufficient time to get all the forces aligned together. That's why the Prime Minister wanted to call it in some sort of haste this summer, before things get even worse. You need to realise that to get a campaign group together takes a long time. It's happening, but I like to have seen it happen a little bit quicker, perhaps.
That's kind of interesting. Can you see what happened in Ireland happening here? That you go to a vote, you make a decision, and they say, well, that's not right. We'll go back and vote again until you get it right.
Well, in fact, this could be the eternal dread, that we would get an outvote on the 23rd of June, but within a year or two, David Cameron's government would be trying to persuade us it was the wrong decision, trying to get us to vote again.
Two-year gap between the vote and the actual happening.
Well, indeed. Mm-hmm. We shall see. But I do hope we get honesty at Westminster level and that the wishes of the people are respected.
Can you see that happening, though?
As you said earlier, we don't know what the future brings. I haven't got a crystal ball today.
Yeah. So back to the people talking to you in the street, which is the only thing you can actually talk about, really, because they're the people giving you their views.
Yes.
How many actually come up to you and say, we're not really sure, try and persuade us?
Only a small proportion
really?
Now. I think most people have probably made up their minds by
one way
now.
Or the other.
Mm-hmm. And don't forget, a lot of people will neglect to vote anyway. I don't know what the turnout will be on the 23rd of June. It'll be about the same as the general election, probably, about
so
two-thirds.
Pretty good, then.
So it'll be good, but a large proportion of people probably will not even bother to vote. But that's the way it works.
Yeah. What about young people? Are they very involved in this, do you think?
I think they are. I do hope that young people realise the benefits they would have of an independent country in the future, where they can actually...
But most young people seem to be wanting to go out.
Well,
stay in.
Yeah, I hope they see that self-determination is important. Now, most young people don't want to live at home with mum and dad for the rest of their lives. They want to be independent, they want self-determination, they want to make their own decisions, and so it has to be with countries, and that would benefit them enormously in the coming decades.
It's much more cosy staying at home with mum and dad.
It's much cheaper.
Mike, good luck to you. Thank you so much indeed.
Thank you, Mike.
Our guest today has been Mike Glennon, former head of the UKIP people in West Sussex, in West Sussex Council, in fact. And we'll see you back at another vote very soon. Thanks for your company.